I think it's very important to talk, like, where exactly the reproductive tourism, or when we talk about, I'm looking at particularly the surrogacy tourism, and also a little bit on the egg donation or egg sale, whatever we call it. Take it to the infertility. Like, I think it's very important to look at the expanding definition. It has reduced the time frame over the years, has resulted in more and more infertile people seeking and more infertile people seeking assistance reproduction. Like, how it has been changed, you know, in 1975, a couple was only declared infertile after 5 years of unprotected coitus. And in WHO, which I think it is very important to talk about the role of WHO here too, has reduced the time period to 2 years. And then now we have, it is only 1 year. And then even the Indian Council of Medical Research and Ministry of Health and Family Welfare said very clearly in the policy brief and even in their guidelines, it is only 1 year time period. So whose, you know, benefit that definition has been arrived, that is very important to look at. And then the second issue in the context is the inadequacies of public health system. I'm sure you're all familiar with that. And there is a lack of absence or poor basic preventive infertility care in the public sector. Even at the tertiary level, we don't even have any semen testing at the tertiary level, or there is no infertility management at the tertiary level. Forget about primary health. And then the third important aspect is we have to talk about the intersection of patriarchy and market. Somebody brought in gender when Vandana was presenting. I think it is very important to bring back the discourse. Like, we forget the word patriarchy most often. Gender has come into the mainstream, but it is very important to talk in the context of particularly in India and South Asia. We have to talk about patriarchy and the connection with the market. So that is something which I would like to focus, which actually both of them glorify motherhood as the natural destiny of all women. If you are a woman, you have to be a mother, and you have to be a biological mother. That is what the definition is perceived by the society and the market now. And then the last but the least is the globalization of services, which includes medical services, and that the rise of the reproductive tourism in the country. Which I said already, it's not recognized as a public health issue. I want to go back a little bit into the genesis of origin. I'm sure most of you are familiar, like, within 6 years of the birth of the world's first test tube baby in 1978, the government of India sponsored work on IVF at the National Institute for Research in Reproduction in Mumbai. And the first published Indian IVF baby was born in 1986 from the same institute in Mumbai. And this, that was unpublished, so Durga was born. Like, before that it was Durga in Calcutta, but it was not documented properly. So that's, the government claims that this is the first IVF baby born in KEM, and then that is something which is repeatedly stated. Then it has been soon taken over by the booming private sector in health, especially the corporate sector. So if you look at the surrogacy services, I want to put it in quotes actually, are mostly available in the private sector. Very few, particularly right now, only All India Institute of Medical Sciences, which is the premier institute in Delhi, which provides altruistic surrogacy. And they don't enter into the commercial surrogacy. There are two different kinds of surrogacy, which I come to that later. I want to take back a little bit into the, you know, aspect of medical tourism and the fertility tourism. There are a lot of debates within the feminist movement. Can we say reproductive tourism? I'm not going for any fun. I'm going for either for a procedure or for an arrangement or for a treatment. I'm involved physically and mentally, so can I, you know, make it, compare it with, you know, tourism kind of perspective? That debate is still happening. But coming back to the medical tourism, like, we all know, like, with the globalization of trade in services and the rise in medical tourism, India has emerged as an attractive destination for medical services and more recently reproductive services. As corporatized healthcare pushes medical tourism, the Indian state is also extending its support to this burgeoning sector. If you look at it, the Indian government endorses and promotes medical tourism by offering easy access and financial incentives like low interest rates for loans provided to establish a hospital, special medical visas we have, subsidized rates for land for these clinics. According to the Union Minister of Tourism, the Indian government is issuing M, that is medical visas to medical tourists, and MX visas to accompanying spouses, which are valid for a year. So even the Indian National Health Policy 2002 also promotes this. And it says very clearly to capitalize on the comparative cost advantage enjoyed by the domestic health facilities in the secondary and tertiary sector, NHP 2002 strongly encourages the providing of such health services on a payment basis to service seekers from overseas. So you are neglecting your own country's health structure, but you are promoting medical tourism and then encouraging the corporate sector and the private sector. So next is, for the last few years, India's fertility industry has experienced rapid expansion, within the country emerging as one of the leading global destinations for fertility tourism, particularly for commercial surrogacy. And ARTs, like its assisted reproductive technology, often people think it's antiretroviral treatment, but here it is assisted reproductive technologies, which assist reproduction, I just want to define that, and increases the chances of conception and carrying a pregnancy to term. It includes, you know, IVF, in vitro fertilization, and there are many variations like ICSI and others. And surrogacy has been part of this ART, though surrogacy is not a treatment, and it is an arrangement, but it has come under the umbrella of assisted reproductive technologies. And the fertility tourism, it's a large proportion of those seeking commercial surrogates in India were well-off Indians residing both in and outside of India, but in the last few years, a sharp increase in demand from non-Indian patients has shifted this balance. Fertility tourists now come to India in search of surrogates from a wide range of countries, including Britain, France, US, you know, Canada, you can see the names like. And what are the multiple factors driving this demand? Over the last quarter century, you know, legislation of fertility treatments in the industrialized North has grown increasingly strict. Laws in many countries prohibit specific procedures like commercial surrogacy, particularly the commercial surrogacy and egg donation, and produce serious administrative delays. So that is one factor. And then the other factors, the niche marketing of fertility tourism gaining traction, particularly in India, where the combination of substantially lower costs, advanced privatized tertiary healthcare, English-speaking providers, and apparently ample supply of Indian women interested in serving as surrogates. A business climate that encourages the outsourcing of Indian labor, world-famous tourist destinations, possibility of closely monitoring surrogates, the absence of binding industry regulations provide powerful incentives to foreign consumers of fertility services. I will try to, you know, corroborate with the studies which we have done over the last 8 years, interacting with the couples who are going for ART procedures, or we have done a lot of ethnographies documenting the lives of surrogate mothers. So I will bring that, you know, interspersed when I'm talking about, you know, what do we mean by monitoring, or what do we mean by, you know, the tourist destination, how it has been promoted. I'm coming back to the surrogacy industry here. We don't have any reliable statistics for how many surrogacies are arranged in India. We don't have any national registry at this point of time. And anecdotal evidence and media reports point to a sharp rise in the instances of commercial surrogacy. According to one estimate, India's rapidly growing commercial surrogacy industry is worth US$445 million per year. This is from one of the sources, media sources, and some of the academic papers. So the fertility industry, it is expected to bring in additional annual revenue of 1 to 2 billion. That is, again, the Confederation of Indian Industry, CII's estimate, it is 1 to 2 billion it will be this year. And there we have a society called the Indian Society for Assisted Reproduction. We can, you know, estimate from that, like, there is a sharp increase in the membership. Most of them are providing IVF services and also surrogacy. So that has been increased. So, and then on that estimate, we can say, yeah, it is spreading. And it has been now moved to smaller cities and towns. to exploit the market in these areas and indeed to create them. You know, that is also happening. And India has emerged as a center for destination for people wishing both to have assisted reproduction and for surrogacy. Indeed, the surrogacy business alone, which I said is 445. And for example, in Mumbai alone, you know, these are the actors and institutions who are involved. Like you have 44 institutions providing ERT and IVF services. This is from our own study, recent study, which we have done with Jawaharlal Nehru University and King's College London. And 14 institutions providing surrogacy services among that. 16 are providing stem cell and cord blood banks. There is an interlinkage, you know, how the market is, you know, bringing in all these elements. Like in an IVF clinic, if you have spare embryos, what is the fate of those spare embryos? They are going for stem cell research. I think we need to map these, you know, linkages, and then also we have to map these global chains, which is very, very crucial. We have seen this overlap. I couldn't do the diagram because I was very unwell, but you can see these three circles are interlinked: IVF, surrogacy, and the stem cell and cord blood banks. And you have 8 medical tourism companies who are operating, and you have 3 surrogacy law firms in Mumbai, according to our study, which we could map in Mumbai. But it varies from city to city, town to town. And we have these private healthcare consultants, we have the hospitality industry, we have the tourism. Government is also encouraging. We have the, and interestingly, we have these collaborations between foreign hospitals and the companies. Like, we have done 2 interviews, one in California, it's called Planet Hospital. And they have a huge clientele coming from there. His name is Rudy Rupak. He does with Rotunda in Mumbai. Like, it's a big company, and then they organize this. Like, you don't need to go anywhere, like how it gets operated in this globalized scenario. And there is in Florida, it's called Proactive Solutions. They are heavily engaged. Even in UK, you can see that. You know, that is where the King's College came in to map the chain, you know, the global chains, how we can join these dots when we talk about the industry. So coming back to the cost, a little bit to give an idea. The cost of hiring a surrogate in India ranges from $6,000 to $8,000, but it is again the city to city and the clinic to clinic and the negotiating power. And if you have agents involved, it is very different. I'll come to that little bit later from the personal testimonies. And it is $6,000 to $8,000 as against about $80,000 in the USA. You can see the disparity, 80 in US, 8 in India. Although there are wide variations, the cost of IVF in India is about $500 for each cycle compared to 5,000 in USA. So ART industry also offers a regular supply of spare ova to another industry, namely, which I mentioned just now, the stem cell therapy industry. India has announced a public-private partnership with these 3 European pharmaceutical companies and the British government for stem cell research. It has come in Hindu 2007. We want fitness to carry the pregnancy, to, and then we have to look healthy. The surrogates should look healthy. And the demand for a specific religion and caste, like if it is a lower caste, you get less. If I'm an upper caste Brahmin, there's 1 lakh extra you get. Fair, good looking, tall, hygiene, respectable seat, that is also something which you need. And the recruitment patterns, which I said, there are multiple actors who are involved. The agents are flourishing. And how much, you know, the cut they take from the surrogate and also from the clinic, which is very important to look at. And there is the medical tourism agencies are also approaching the independent agencies to look into this business. So what are the motivations to become? Because unemployment is a struggle to run a household. No other work options because of, you know the informalized labor, you know about the SEZ, and then many of these, like women are pushed into this sector now. And the large sum of money, responsibility of paying off debts, buying a house, these are the things which women often say. And creating savings for the children, better option than domestic work or factory work or sex works, even that also they said. And it's creating a life for a child, benevolence, altruism, which also comes in. And sometimes they are pushed. And in, they don't have any information. These are from our, there no informed consent were taken many times. They don't know much about the contracts, and then who are drawing the contracts, we have no idea. And there are a lot of health risks which were hidden quite a bit, because you don't talk about the long-term side effects of the, you know, the invasive hormonal cycles, because if you're pushed into a gestational surrogacy or IVF, like what kind of, and there are multiple embryo transfers which are happening, which is, it is extremely problematic. You transfer multiple embryos and you are doing the fetal reduction. So that is something which is very problematic. At the same time, you're also doing sex selection. We have seen, I can select an embryo because it's there in the petri dish. Like I want, you know, the a boy, a male embryo, and then I want to cryopreserve the female and then the spare embryos. So this is something which is, and then one of the surrogate was asked to come to Thailand, and she'll be paid much more money because there she can go for a sex selective abortion, and then the test and then abortion. These are all the practices which I have. Most of them are C-section deliveries, and it is all controlled pregnancies. Like when the commissioning couple come down, you have to deliver the child. You know how it has been orchestrated, and then post-delivery, who is responsible? After handing over the baby, you are out. So that is something which is very, very important. And then talking about the remuneration, it ranges. I just give a quote here. This is one of the surrogates. She said, no, I don't know about that. The agent get a lot and give us very little. We'll have such information they give us after making their cut. And the, this is the D is a surrogacy agent. He takes percentage from both sides. And that is something which we have seen across the, you know, Mumbai, Delhi, Punjab, and Hyderabad. Coming to the regulation, I'll just take 2 minutes here, which is very, very important in the context of governance. It defines and enforces roles, rights, and responsibilities of all actors, and then hold the government accountable to the enforcement of those roles, rights, and responsibilities, and to protect the surrogate's health and human rights. So we, civil society pressure in India, and, you know, like Dr. Bhargava and all, they were actually took up this issue. They said, we need regulation within the country. You cannot let this industry grow. So that's where the, you know, the guidelines came in 2005, and they are not legally binding, though there is a little bit of, they say no, yes, which you can clarify later. But then we have a bill now. 2008, they came up with a bill, and then 2010, it has been revised. But it falls short of addressing many concerns vis-a-vis women's health and child rights perspective, which is very, very crucial. We cannot forget children who are born through commercial surrogacy in this entire industry. So that is where we were demanding to, we are not saying regulate it, but make it much more comprehensive, which can be in the interest of surrogate mother, who is vulnerable, who comes from a poor background, and the children. So it is a transnational practice where I want, you know, you all to pay a little more attention here. It's often with commercial as well as social, political, and economic implications. Banning surrogacy in India, there is a huge debate in the country. Ban, prohibit. You know, we don't use the word ban actually. We say in summer, prohibit. But it may merely drive the demand elsewhere. Although a sovereign government deciding on legislation may not consider such an outcome to be their concern from the standpoint of NGOs advocating a particular approach, it is worth considering whether a prohibition truly advances the broader cause of women's health and human rights, or merely pushes the problem off onto a more vulnerable population of women in other countries, as appears to be the case in both Canada and then UK, as well as a host of other countries whose governments have opted to ban surrogacy, but whose citizens remain free to pursue surrogacy services abroad. And given the significant and increasing cross-border movement for ART treatment and surrogacy, how possible is an international level covenant or international guideline or any resolution or any recommendation? How do we regulate cross-border? Like, can we use the CEDA? But US has not been ratified CEDA, if you look at the US background. So who, like who comes under CEDA? Like if it has been like, can there be universal covenant? Or where exactly? I think it is for the commission to think about. It is not India specific, it is cross-border tourism. And you know, crossing bodies and crossing borders actually. It is a transnational surrogacy which is happening. So a ban may does little or nothing to reduce the demand for surrogacy services. That is where I come from. I'm saying that. And it often, you know, have the perverse effect of driving underground markets in considering whether a ban is the right choice for India or not. It may be instructive to consider India's recent efforts to exercise legal control over another industry that raises similar health and human rights concerns. So we know about the Organ Sale Act, like in 1994, what it did, Transplantation of Human Organs Act, it limits organ sourcing to organ donation by relatives. The act has done little to halt organ sale. Indeed, it has fueled the growth of wide-scale black market for kidneys and other organs with human rights abuses and negative health outcomes of organ sellers. So what are the actions? A lot of actions. It is also a nascent debate in the country. You know, we were, you know, focusing mostly on sex selective abortions and population control policies. But then in that continuum, we could see there is something which is coming into the country, which has been mushroomed all over the country, perpetrating into the small towns. This is the other side is called, it's not just, you know, assisted now. Otherwise, if we were looking at contraceptive, now we are looking at conceptive technologies. So how do we take them? How do we look at them? And then now women's movement and legal rights movement, ethics movement, and the feminists are engaging with it. And there is a lot of research which is coming. And then there is a lot of research which is coming from abroad too. Like every day we get one request. We want to, you know, document surrogate. Can you provide the media and then the students? Definitely. But it's a good step. We Summer has taken up this issue for the last 8 years. Organize national international consultations because it is transnational. You can talk about India, but what happens when the Israeli couple come here or when the couple are coming from UK, and what happens when it is being prohibited in countries? So in sum, what this is, I recommend enact national legislation covering a wide range of ART and genetic technologies that permits and regulates both commercial and non-commercial surrogacy under the law. And it, along with other technologies, should be governed by a clear, comprehensive regulatory scheme, and it should define and enforce the role, rights and responsibilities and remedies of all institutions. If you go back to the policy brief when you have time, the regulation doesn't talk about the other players. They don't come under the purview of the bill. It's only the clinics will come under regulation. So what happens to the ART banks or surrogacy agents or the law firms? They don't come under the law. And we were also talking about the citizenship of the child. For example, we had, like Dr. Bhargava has suggested, a French embassy which came here, the ministry from the French government. They wanted to meet us. They somehow felt that we are the hurdle to pass the bill in the parliament, but that is not true. And then they were like, Dr. Bhargava recommended them to, you know, meet us when they were here. And then they, in France, it has been banned, the commercial, like Italy and then many of the Eastern European countries. And you have a list at the back of that report, actually, which countries prohibit. And then they wanted, there is one particular clause, like, which is very progressive in that way in the revised bill, which is there in it. But it's not legal. Like in France prohibits, when the couple come here, the access, because in India it is open, because there is no law, it is legal. So you come here, you have the child, and then what is the citizenship of the child when the child goes back to France? He has been sent to the foster home. So that's where the child rights come in. Like what will happen to the children who are born when they're the countries which do not permit surrogacy? That is an issue which we all need to think. So I'm not going much into the policy and the bill actually, but I thought if we have time, you know, we can do it later through emails or any queries. And we want the government now to regulate it, definitely, whatever with its limitations, but it should be in the interest of surrogate, because one example is that the previous 2008 bill, which said you have to pay 75% when the surrogate woman enters into the arrangement and the rest in 3 installments. The 2010 bill says in 5 installments you have to pay to the surrogate. You pay 25% in the beginning, After handing over the child, the commissioning couple will pay the 75%, which we find it extremely violating the rights of the woman if there is a miscarriage, if there is a death of the child. So the surrogate is not going to get the money, which is problematic. These are the 2-3 clauses which we are actually fighting with ICMR to change, make it, you know, very comprehensive, which can protect the rights of the vulnerable population. Thank you so much.